Just happy to be here all today. I'm going to be brief on this morning. We had our bishop's call last night, and while we were waiting for everyone to get on, there was a few of us that were talking and just shooting the breeze, and I happened to ask one of them, what was he preaching on today? Elder Dillard will know who I'm talking about in a few seconds. His college team had won yesterday, and the Notre Dame was playing Carolina. Mm-hmm. And he had mentioned how he had no faith in Notre Dame, but if Notre Dame pulled it off, that he'd be able to preach a little bit harder on today. And so I asked him, I said, well, what are you going to preach on? He said, well, it's Super Bowl Sunday. All you know, you can do is just throw something in about the Panthers and everybody get happy. He said you could talk about dabbing or something and everybody would be happy. And I said, well, I can't do that because I'd probably get up and talk about how they need to lose. And he said, well, no, they'll walk out your church then. So I can't talk Super Bowl today. But I'm going to be brief and I want to share something with you. I'm kind of stuck, and I do not apologize for it, but I'm kind of stuck because I feel this now thing is real, and this living in the now, as we said a couple weeks ago, the gospel of now, I believe it is real, and I'm stuck there until now, and so I want to talk to you again about the gospel of now, but as we were going through praise and worship, I was thinking about something and scripture came to mind, and I want to share that with you, and then we'll probably let you go. But I've been having a few vivid dreams here lately. First of all, I need you, and I don't say this. Well, I've been having some vivid dreams lately. And I haven't shared them with anyone. I've just been holding them close to my vest. But this last one I had on last night, early this morning, it was so vivid and so. And the thing about it was it was a dream, but I was kind of awoke while I was dreaming it, and it was so. So strong until when there was a point where I wanted to open my eyes and see what time it was, but I purposely kept my eyes closed because I didn't want to get out of it. And it was a two-part dreaming, and the first part of it, the Lord showed me, he took me into a place of dryness, a place of emptiness. There you go. Took me to a place of emptiness, and I got to see, and it wasn't just a arbitrary empty place. It was a place of emptiness that I have been. And it was kind of like I was being ushered around to see this empty place. And then as I was thinking about it during praise and worship, the scripture came to mind. And let me read part of it, and then you probably know where I'm going. And then we can, if you know where I'm going, then you can hurry up and get there. And then by the time I get there, we can go home. But I was in this place of emptiness, and a familiar place. There you go, a familiar place of emptiness. I was in a familiar place of emptiness that it seems like I've been there and I was accustomed to everything that was there. I was familiar with everything that was there. And the scripture came to mind, and it says this. It says, the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of a valley which was full of bones. This is Ezekiel 37. Verse 2, and caused me to pass by them round about, and behold, there were many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And I promise you I'm not making any of this up. I was in the dream, and it was this really dead place, this really familiar place of dryness, and then shortly after I was ushered into there, it was like I was ushered into another scene, and in this new scene, it was there were a lot of familiar faces. There was a couple. There was a couple familiar faces, but then there was a lot of new faces. And it looked like I was being ushered in. Sister Donna, to a special seat, and as I got to that special seat, before I got to the special seat, one of the familiar faces tried to attach themselves to me, and tried to, forgive me for using this word, for saying this word, but tried to ride my coattail. When beforehand that familiar face was a cause of the dryness in my life. And so this familiar face tried to attach themselves to me, and the great thing about it was the usher or the spirit that was upon me quickly repelled that familiar face. And I was ushered into to a special seat. And it was a seat, when I first came in, it was a seat. I saw the person that had occupied the seat before. But then I was ushered into that seat. And next thing I saw was myself up preaching to a lot of new faces. And one of the things that I heard in the message, and you know, you've always been told as a preacher, you've always been told when things come to you, you need to write it down. But I was in this dream and I didn't want to come out of it. It was so strong and I didn't want to come out of it. And so I said, like I said, I kept my eyes closed because I didn't want to come out of it. I didn't want to move. I didn't want anything to disturb the dream. And one of the things that came out was the words coming that says, you must remain humble. And it just kept repeating itself, you must remain humble. And so as I look at this dream, and as I look at what's in my heart and what I really feel, the scripture then continues on after being in the valley of dry bones. It says, and he said unto me, prophesy, verse 4, unto these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and ye shall live. Then I jump over to Joel, the second chapter. The rest of that passage, the first through the 11th verse, talks about how he then spoke to the to the bones and spoke to the winds from the east and the west and the north and the south, and they came together and they blew upon the bones, and the bones came together bone by bone, and flesh came upon the bones, and they became a living fighting army. And in Joel, the second chapter and verse 25, he says, "And I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God." And I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, I'm saying, okay, God, this is, and to be honest with you, this is like the third dream I had in this realm. And so I'm sitting, I'm saying, okay, God, now I get it, but I want to make sure I got it. Because if we're dealing with the now, then we have to look at it and make sure we understand that there are some things in some areas that have been desolate for a long time in our life. And they've been to the place where people have pronounced them as being dead. And help me out, Sister Young, in the medical term, that what they do is they call it, come on, yeah, Sister Kyle, you there? When a person is dead, they have to call the time. And they have to give a time and say, time of death. And then they give the time. And so therefore, that's when the person is officially called dead. And there have been areas, there have been situations, there have been circumstances that has been dead, and people have pronounced it dead. They've given it a time of death. And a lot of people have already had the funeral for it, and they said that you'll never come out of that. You'll never come alive again in that area. You might as well just do something else, because that is dead. But God said, he said, can they live again? Mm-hmm. And then he says, this is what you do. Because I have said to you that I'm going to restore everything. So therefore, what you got to do is you got to speak to it in order for it to be restored. Wow. And so I'm in the dream, and I'm looking at it, and everything is going, and it just looks like it looks, be honest with you, that's one reason why I didn't want to get out of it, because it was so good. It started out not good, but it ended where I didn't want to come out of, because it was so good. And what I want you to understand is as we're dealing with the gospel of the now, you have to understand that the now might start off bad. But as you prophesy according to the word of the Lord, and as you speak to it according to the word of the Lord, it then changes just that quick. And you start experiencing it, and what was a dry, familiar place is no longer familiar anymore. How? Wow. Your familiarity becomes new, because you're no longer associated with dry deadness. You become associated with the newness of life. And so I looked at scriptures, and I tried to get me some scriptures this morning, and I got some scriptures, and trying to talk about the blessings, and the one scripture in Proverbs 10 and 22 says, "The blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich, and he added no sorrow with it." I like the Amplified version says this. It says, "The blessing of the Lord bring true riches, and he adds no sorrow to it, for it comes as a blessing from God." Hey, God help me. 3 John 2, beloved, I wish above all things that you may prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. The Amplified says, beloved, I pray that in every way you may succeed and prosper and be in good health physically. Yes. Just as I know your soul prospers spiritually. And I sit there again. I y'all forgive me for going back to the dream, but it's I told you it's the, like the third one that was in this vein, and I'm saying I don't want to get ahead of God. I don't want to get ahead of God, but I don't want to lag behind either. I don't want to cause God to turn around and say, where are you? Because if he has to turn around and say, where are you, then I missed the mark. But I love being in that place. That place where the newness felt good. You ever tried on something new? No. I know all of y'all have been to the car lot and have driven a new car. I ain't talking about the used car. And it's something y'all love the new car smell. And mess up and go to the BMW place and test drive a BMW. You know that your pocket might not be able to handle it, but that bad boy feels good while you test drive. And that's how it feels. It felt so good. So I didn't ever want to get out of it. And so therefore, I say to God, I say, okay, God, what is it you want me to do? He says, speak to him. Death and life is in the power of the tongue. And God's not going to do something for you that he's giving you the power to do yourself. And a lot of times, we find ourselves in the familiar dry place because we won't do what we've been given the power to do. We wait for God to do it. But God says, I've given you the power to do it. Watch this. We wait for God to give us a supernatural financial blessing. But God says this. He says, if you bring the tithes into my storehouse, then I will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. But we want to hold on to things and not do what we've been commanded to do. And then we find ourselves living and familiar with the dry place. But God says, no. He says, I've ushered you out of the dry place. Oh, Lord. I've ushered you out of the dry place. All you got to do is just now speak it. Like I've been saying before, it doesn't take an hour and 50 minutes for me to get a point across to you. You've got to understand that it's simple. It's just that simple. God has ushered you to the place. And we're talking about living in the now. We're talking about seeing your future and commanding your future to begin right now. And what you have to do is you got to speak it and then you got to walk it. You have to speak it, and then you have to walk it. And as I sat there, the last thing, as I told you, that I was told, you must remain humble. You can't experience the blessings of God and be arrogant. You can't experience the blessings of God and then want to throw it in everybody's face. I showed Pastor Tonya a YouTube thing about this preacher who from Missouri who's doing a deposition, and
And you seen it too? And the preacher was doing the deposition because he was living an extravagant life. And he spent what, $30,000 at a Versace or Gucci store just on belts, because the belts have the proper appearance when he's on television. He spent how much was it? Was it $70,000 or $100,000 just to have a Mercedes cut into a limousine so he could pick up guests? And the person that was doing the deposition said, do you feel any kind of way going to spending all this money in these stores and doing all this stuff and then going and telling people to give their offerings? And he said, no, I gotta keep up the image and being arrogant about the blessings of God. And you can't do that. Because as soon as you, what is it? What is it? A haughty spirit comes before the fall. And as soon as you get arrogant, you get cut down. And God says you gotta remain humble. You got to remain humble. When you walk into that newness, when you walk into that blessing, when you walk into the now, you've got to remain humble. You can't win the lotto and then go buy 10 cars.
Well, don't play it.
We saw it on what was it, on Steve Harvey. We saw it on Steve Harvey. This man, he won the lotto and went and got 7 cars, and now he's in jail. And his daughter, it doesn't have any money now because they went too extravagant. You got to remain humble. And when God ushers you into the abundance, remain humble. Remain a servant. Remain a child of the King. Because it's your time. It's your time. Hear me, you. It's your time. You've been in the dry place long enough. Thank you, God. That's why he ushered me into the new place. Because you've been there long enough. If you're faithful over a few things, I'll make you rule over many.
Y'all stand, it's time to go.
Watch out for the leeches. Huh. Watch out for the leeches. Leeches come to suck blood out of you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Wasn't nowhere around when you were struggling. Mm-hmm. But the minute the blessings of the Lord overtake you and make you rich, they want to attach themselves to you. I knew God was going to do it for you all along. Mm-hmm. Well, where were you when I needed some help? I said you was anointed to do this. I even called it out a long time ago. Well, why did you turn your back on me?
Somebody help me out. Elder Dillon, you help me out. You, Brother Jimmy, y'all used to serve in the military. Y'all help me out. How you get rid of them? Do you put some fire to them and they fall off?
You're supposed to put fire to them, yeah. But then they say you're not supposed to just take it off. Pull it off.
You're a leech, you put some fire to them. Mm-hmm. And they fall off. Take me back to my dream because the familiar face that tried to attach itself to me, mm-hmm. it started to feel good, but then the spirit that was with me repelled me. And you gotta allow the spirit to work when you move. Don't dispel the spirit of God. Don't silence the spirit of God. Because the spirit of God is what's going to protect you in your new place.
Mm. Oh Lord, I bless you. For giving me my eviction notice from the dry place.
Thank you, Lord.
Not only did you give it to me, but you packed my bags. Hmm. And you moved me into this wealthy place. I pray for these your people. While in the dry place, they adapted. But now, God, I pray that your spirit changed their mind and their heart. So where they will not be familiar with the dry place anymore. But as they walk into the new place, they are already prepared spiritually, mentally, emotionally to handle your newness that you've given them. Teach us how to handle your blessing. Teach us how to walk and talk in this newness. I pray for a humble spirit, a humble heart, a humble mind. Thank you for the overflowing of your anointing and your power and your blessing. Thank you for the protection of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for giving us the command to speak it. For when we speak it, it comes together. And we bless you and we praise you for the newness and for the overflow. We give you glory, we give you honor. Now I pray special blessings upon each and every one that's here. Pray for the Edwards family.
In your presence.
The Monroe family, the Kitt family, the Cloud family. The Dillards, the Young, the Tuckers, the Andersons, the Raeforders. I thank you.
In your presence.
Pray for the Connor families during this difficult time in their life. I pray a special blessing be upon each and every one. Pray that the Holy Spirit encamp themselves around the bottom and your angels protect them and keep them as they experience this newness of life. Open our eyes to see the legions. Give us the words to command them to go.
Hey. I'll be away,
though. Say, I'm here because I chose to be here because I chose to be here. Nobody forced me. I'm here because I love to be. I'm here in your it's my favorite place. I'm here because I want to be.
Every friend ain't a friend.
I made a conscious decision. I'm here.
Every family member ain't a friend.
Come on, sir. Say a word.
We've been tried and fired, but we come out as the Lord. And we celebrate you, and we thank you so much for your leading of your Holy Spirit. Take us home, Satan. We give you all glory, we give you all honor. You're the only worthy, there is none like you. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, let's put our hands together one time. Come on.
Hallelujah. Glory to your name, God.
Go walk in the newness of life. God bless you.